All right, so we are in the 19th day of school. And today, I'm going to talk to you about what is called implicit differentiation. All right, so there are some functions, sorry, there are some plots that are not functions that we are interested in. A simple, silly example is a circle. This is not a function, but we can describe it mathematically. And it does not nicely turn into a function because you wind up playing with a positive and a negative. You have to break this up into parts. So, standard equation of a circle, or rather, let's just call this the unit circle, is that. Now, if I wanted to take the derivative at a point, let's just say I wanted to find out the slope of the line here, the slope of the tangent line at that point. We might have a little bit of issue. We might just have to say, all right, well, using just the tools that you have in your toolbox, you would have to say, all right, solve for y, get that square root. We know we want the positive square root, and we can play with that derivative and whatnot, okay? But there are some functions that are really goofy. And I collected a few, threw them into a box, kept them starved for a few days. And I'm ready to show you them. Here's one, a rotated ellipse. Now, I'm gonna hold on, let me see if I can just get this a little bit bigger. And you can see that, whoops. You can see that the equation for this guy is a little bit trickier. You have 7x squared minus 10.39xy plus 13y squared. This thing does not play particularly nicely, but there are some really fun ones out there. The bifolium of Descartes. Now, this function has, it's not a function, sorry. This graph, this plot, x to the third minus 6xy plus y to the third equals 0. So this is a function of x and y, okay? And we've got lots of other fun ones. A regular old bifolium. Yeah, almost kind of like a butterfly wing, yeah. Now there are different ways that we can describe this, and you can see the equation, x to the fourth, 20x squared, y squared minus 40x squared y plus y to the fourth equals 0. This thing is not easy to solve for y. Okay? And in fact, if you really wanted to do it and describe it as a quote-unquote function, you would have to break this guy up and deal with it as several parts. Okay? In fact, this guy back here, you would have to describe in two parts, at least three parts. One going from negative infinity up to this maximum right here. Well, great. Now I messed up my whole curve. Well, fine. And then there would have to be the part from here to zero, the upper part of this loop. And then the third part would have to be this spinning off tail. Okay? You'd have to chop it up into three pieces. And they would not be nice functions, really. But this is much more compact as it sits. A very familiar shape, a lemniscate. Okay? And again, this thing is not going to play nice if you wanted to fact. I mean, think about that. Try factoring that beast. No, thank you, Ronco, no. Okay. Waiter, check, please. A sisoid. Now, you might think that that would be a little easier. Yeah, sure. X squareds and Y squareds and stuff like that. Things that go bump in the night. Kappa curve. They're historical. They come back to So, like, for example, obviously, the one from Descartes, what was it? Bifolium, sorry, that's a great word. You know, these are things that people wrote about. Scissoid comes from the same root that we get scissor, and abscisic acid. And if anybody remembers the one of the muses in Greek mythology, the three sisters that spun the thread that determined the length of your life, the one with the scissors was called abscissa. And a cruciform, because it has the shape of a cross, a crux, two things cross. All right, so there are some, and oh, I don't have the equation for this. Oh, great, it's got to be on the other screen. And you can see that, you know, x squared y squared minus 9x squared minus 4y equals 0. So there are some really goofy shapes out there that are not functions that we want to be able to take derivatives of from time to time, because it's fun. All right. So we have to find a way to take a derivative without having to explicitly solve for y and have only one variable. Now, we have to remember that when we take a derivative, we're looking for this. How does y change with respect to x? That's what you're looking for. Now, that means that in my equation here, you can take a derivative of x squared in your sleep. Y squared, when you take a derivative of him, you see y is a function of x. So when you take a derivative of this, you have to do the following. You have to say, remember, that was the same thing as this. You were looking for y prime, right? That's what you're always looking for. This becomes, and I should say this, let's just do it straight. This becomes 2x. Now, if I take the derivative of that, you have to imagine that y is a function by itself, and it is being squared, which means that you're dealing with a composition of functions, y inside the function of a square. So first you have to use the chain rule. And then, just like in what the chain rule says, you take the derivative of the thing inside it. And the derivative of the thing inside it is y prime. And then the derivative of 1 is 0. Okay? So that y squared, we just did the chain rule on. Took the outer layer off, took the derivative of the interior. Now we can solve for y prime, which is the derivative that we were looking for. So you divide by 2y, and this kind of makes sense. Wait, I forgot my prime, sorry, my y prime. If you think about that for a minute, if I drew a point right there, the slope of that tangent line would be undefined, right? It would be a vertical line, right? And if you plug in the point xy, in this case, 1, 0, into my derivative function, negative x over y, you get division by 0, which is undefined. So that kind of makes sense. If we go all the way up to here, my slope at the top is 0. And if we plug in this point, 0, 1, into here, we get that 0 slope again, right? And if you tried, say, the point at a 45-degree angle, right there, the slope, the x and the y values would both be the same, square root of 2 over 2. which would be 1. In fact, watch the negative sign, the slope would be negative 1. Because both my x and my y value, the x and y values are the same at that point, right? So this is the process of what's called implicit differentiation. You can now take derivatives of goofy stuff. Let's do some. Sir. Y prime, because that's what we're looking for. We're done. We found Y prime. The derivative of Y is a result of taking the derivative of this. You see, we took the derivative, if you think about this, okay, it's the chain rule, okay? First, I deal with the squared. Then I take the derivative of the inside. The derivative of y is y prime. That's what it means. If you think about it, like when I said the first derivative and the second derivative and you know, higher order derivatives, we're talking about, you know, some function of x. Well, the derivative of this function is f prime. Good. You don't trust me. All right, that's fine. Too easy, huh? I understand.
That's why I'm scared.
Don't be scared. All right, let's try the following. This is a lemniscate. It looks like this. If you were to graph it, that's what it would look like. Okay, it's kind of a off-axis infinity sign, right? Yeah. Now, let's go ahead and try this derivative. So, I take the derivative of the left-hand side, and I wind up with 3, and the 2 comes in front, x squared plus y squared, and this 2 up here gets reduced down to 1, so I've just got one of them now, and now I take the derivative of the inside. The derivative of the inside is 2x plus, now when I take the derivative here, I get the chain rule, 2y, y prime. Now we take the derivative of the right hand side. Don't forget you got to do both, right? And this is the product rule. First, the derivative of the first guy, which is x, so we just get 1. And now the derivative of the second guy. Yeah, there's a product rule. Did I say that? I'm not sure, but I did? Okay, all right. Okay. Well, now here's where the algebra really kind of comes into play, because now we got to get y prime alone. We got it in two different places, okay? So things might get a little funky here, but it's okay. It'll all work out. Remember, you just want all the y's together, because if you've got two of them, somewhere down the road, you're going to group them together. You're going to have the terms that contain the y primes in them. You're going to factor out that y prime as a GCD and isolate. All right? So let's do a little housekeeping. Sorry. Out of luck. Now, yeah, sorry. I was thinking how far ahead I should be going, and I lost track of myself. And we gotta foil this guy. One second. Yeah. Good. Making sure I'm on the right track. All right. So. It's going to get ugly. So I get 6 up 12. Now, remember, you just want the y primes together, okay? You just want to get all of them together on one side, move everybody off to the other side, and deal with them all separately. So we've got three targets, and let's put them all together and move everyone else away. Lost an X. Let me answer that as soon as I finish this line, okay? I will answer it. Just give me a hot second. Sorry, I'm running out of room. And... So all I did was just rearrange everybody to put all my Y prime pieces together and all my other pieces onto the other side. Now to answer your question, how did I get this right-hand side to look like him? Okay, the product rule. So it's the derivative of X, which is just 1, times Y. And then this one is X, and then the derivative of Y, which is Y prime. Is that cool? Yes? So far? Lie to your teacher? Yes. Wonderful. And now, once you've grouped all of your Y prime terms together, now you have a GCD of a Y prime. Yeah, right. You might have other GCD pieces too, but I don't really care. I mean, we're not looking for the most beautiful expression of this. What we're looking for is something that works. Okay? And we factor Did I mess up somewhere? Which piece? It's easy to drop something if... Okay. I think it looks okay. All right. Now we've pulled Y out, and now we just move that gigantic trinomial underneath, and we're done. Like I said, it's a whole lot of algebra, but that's not the end of... It's not really the end of the world. That's it. Huh? I didn't hear.
Back at the top.
Yeah.
You distribute the 1 points to both the X and the Y.
At the top. You're stuck on this?
Like, I was wondering, you keep it 100 with it?
Yeah. I was just kind of breaking down the right-hand side a little bit further. Why the 100 went to both pieces. Okay. Let's try and do this one. Ooh, that one's fun. Let's go ahead and do that one. Why don't you try? You can do it on the boards, please. If you want to do it on the boards, do it on the boards. You want to do it on the paper, do it on your paper, but do it. That's okay. If it is, yeah, I'll look at all of that. Yeah, that's probably how I'm going to do it. Is that some sort of odd sisoid?
Hold on, my finish.
How about this? Work on this problem. All right, so let's look at it. Let's go through it. You're going to wind up with lots of stuff, but it's not the end of the world. This guy is just 4x to the third. Now, this middle term has, a little bit more involved pieces to it. So this is the product rule, so we got to take the derivative of this. And now we take the derivative of the second one. So it's x squared times 2 times y prime. And now the third guy is minus 2y, y prime. Stare at it. Convince yourself it's true. And we've got... Yeah, in the middle term, I walk up to it, and the first thing I see is a product of two terms. So I use the product rule. Now, I take the derivative of the first term, which is x squared, and I leave the second guy alone. And then I leave the first guy alone, and I take the derivative of the second guy. Now, let's group all my y prime terms together, and we get... And you can jump to it by factoring out right away, and you get throwing the other terms off to the other side. Okay. And now we just divide out what we don't want. And you're done. Now, of course, you have a GCD of a 2. That would be nice to get out as well. And I'm just going to go ahead and get rid of some signs. So I just pulled out a GCD of negative 2, just to get rid, just because I had 3 negative signs in there, and I could have left them that way, it wouldn't have mattered. How does that work? Okay. Not too bad. It's just an application of the tools that we already have in our toolbox. What can you do with it? Well, if you have some goofy looking curve like that, like the ones I showed you earlier, this is how I would find the derivative of that function, but more specifically, use it to find the slope at a point. Okay, so if I took this goofy thing, and this guy has a graph that looks like this, like him. Okay, the way I see some of my students write their X's, which is ridiculous. Yeah, they do. Yeah, it's like, I don't know. It's like, what's so complicated about crossing two lines? I don't know. But anyway, if you wanted to find the derivative of this thing at a certain point, you would then plug in your x, y value. Okay. All right. Let's try this one. Very straightforward. X squared y squared minus 2x equals 3 equals 3. Now, you got to remember to take the derivative of the other side, too. Mm-hmm. Well, in this case, yeah. And now that's the target, the y prime. So move everybody off. Move these two terms over there. And then divide out by the stuff you don't want. Just move them over. Yeah, subtract them over to the other side. All right, so this one was a little bit nicer. Wasn't too bad, right? Went pretty fast. So again, you have the product rule for the first time, first term. And now the derivative of the second term is just 2. And the derivative of 3 is 0. Okay. And now I'm looking for him. And we're going to move all the other pieces off. So now we wind up with and we can just go ahead and cancel out a 2, right? Turn it into a 1. Yeah, you're right. You're right. You're right. You're right. Watch your signs. All right. And now we're going to divide out what we don't want. and we're done. Did we get that or close to that? Because that was my mistake. Yeah, that's what I just did. All right. All right, let's try this. It's not that bad. It's a product. Okay, now, you know what I would do before I even started this? I would divide by 4, because when you take the derivative of the 1/4, it goes to 0, and then you're not dealing with 4s throughout your whole problem. You know, just to speed it up a little bit. That'll make it a little nicer. At least you're not writing as much. Derivative of sine is cosine. Derivative of cosine is negative sine. So, yeah, you have the product rule. So the derivative of the first times the second. Remember, it's product. Yeah. U prime V plus U V prime. Hey, could you check these markers for me? I've been going through plenty. I don't trust any of them. And again, 3 piles, you know. Mm-hmm. Right. That's where your Y prime comes from. You get it? Yeah. All right, so the derivative of the first term, derivative of sine is cosine.
Sometimes it's true, but that would actually be true.
Yeah. And now, leave the first one alone, times the derivative of the second one. Now, the derivative of cosine is negative sine. Y prime. And the derivative of 1/4 is 0. And that's where my y prime comes from. So now I can say y prime is equal to negative cosine of x cosine of y all over negative sine x sine y, which is equal to, now cosine over sine is cotangent. And cosine of y over sine of y is cotangent again. Yeah. Sure.
Is two divided by square root of
y is that?
Hold on, wait, say that again?
If I change it to cotangent squared x, y, is that legal?
Can't do that.
When you divided...
yeah, that's how I got zero, yeah. When I divided by what?
When so, you divided by sine x times negative sine y?
Yeah.
How did they both...
Because I first thing I did was I moved the cosine x, cosine y over to the other side, and it became a negative, it became my numerator, right? And then I divided by the sine x minus sine y, and that got me my denominator. And since both of them were negative, they canceled that. Right, but the cosine x, cosine y.
You moved it over to the other side, so you subtracted it.
Yeah, I subtracted it. Is that, you see?
Yeah, but one of them would still be negative, right?
Mm-mm. Here, I'll go through it. What? Cool, neat. Watch. See how that flies?
Yeah.
And now, since everybody's multiplied, your negative sign comes out in front, and then you get what I have on the next line.
I realized that you can multiply it so
that you can multiply. Yeah. All right. Was that okay?
Yeah.
A little better? Okay. Now... let's try, all right, now let's do something with a little bit more of fangs and teeth. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, there are functions that are called parametric equations. And I mentioned one when we were in the last flex, that x and y are both functions of another variable, usually t. So x so it's a variable, time is the independent variable, and x is a function, and y is also a function. So in cases like this, you now are dealing with x and x prime, okay, if you think about it. So if I'm doing this, say, for example, that, okay. Yes, you're not only going to, like, that y prime piece is not only just going to be for y. We're going to spread the love over to x, and we're going to wind up with x and x prime, because they're both functions that are being taken a derivative with respect to t, you see?
Which prime do you want to find, x prime or y prime?
You're not specifically isolating either one. Okay. I should be more careful. And now the derivative of the first. And now the derivative of the second. Because we have now a function of two different derivatives, two different slopes. Well, at this point, we can't. There's nothing to, nobody has a GCD except for No, no one does.
But if it was a fact, then
you're done at this point.
I'm saying, if it was a factual.
If you could simplify this, you could. You would. You know, I mean, you know, play with it and get things isolated, yes.
So, will it tell you when T is?
Sure. No. It would have to be explained to you that x is a function in the instructions.
Okay.
Yeah. But I just wanted you to be aware that that can sometimes occur. Okay. All right. Let's do one more for gig. Oh, let's do this. Let's do, let's do my rotated eclipse. Let's just keep my constants under control. So here's what I want. Actually, I left the constant off. Excuse me. Don't cry. Okay. Aww. But here's what I want. I want the slope of the line at the point. That's what I want. I want the slope at that point. So what's going to happen is you're going to take the derivative, okay? You're going to take the derivative, and you're going to solve for y prime, just like a minute ago, and then you're going to plug in that value of that point, and you're going to tell me what my slope is. You're worrying me. Yes. You need to try this. You not just stare at it, but do it. Yes, ma'am. No. These are not functions of time. This is just a garden variety equation, just like everything up to, but not including the last 5 minutes. Not a function of time. Y is a function of x. X is the independent variable. No time. It's the middle term?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all. You could, or you, if you wanted to. Guys, I'm just going to flip the screen for just a second, because there's a slide that I did something like that. No. Here.
Oh, okay.
So, for a minute, ignore the 6 square roots of 3. Just treat it as a constant, leave it out, and then put it back in when you're done. And that'll fly. On their first attempt. Yes, the 2 comes in front like that, and you did that right. But now you got to take the derivative of the inside, which is y prime.
I was thinking like.
Yeah, there should be. Right. You're good. And remember, once you've got it, you isolate y prime, and then once you've got y prime all by herself, then you you plug in your point, square root of 3/1. That's fine. get y prime alone, and then plug in square root of 3 and 1, and tell me what my derivative is there.
I'll actually go through it all.
Okay. I'm hoping everybody got this line. Did everyone get this line of math? In whatever form you might have gotten it in, but.
I got the difference. Okay, so square root of 3 times y minus.
No. Because when your first thing was you take the derivative of him and you leave the y alone. And then you take the derivative. You leave the x alone and you take the derivative of y. Y prime. Right. Now we can rearrange and factor out the y prime. And now we divide out to get y prime alone. It'll get there. You'll be able to do that soon. Okay, now this is great. We've got my derivative, and yeah, you might be able to do something with it. Not really. Yeah, there's nothing real. I mean, no, you can't, because 26 doesn't fly. It's 2 and 13. And, sorry? Yeah, it looks like at first, because you got so much stuff in there, you think that you should be able to pull out a GCD somehow. And sometimes you can, but in this case, I can't. And now I plug in my point, square root of 3, 1. Yes. There is no x prime. Yeah. If you had two different functions. No. No. Right. Oh, darn. Okay, well, we can pick this up during second flex. And at that point, we will distribute textbooks. Okay? This episode of The Ronco Show has been brought to you by Implicit Differentiation and the letter G.